try. Well, good evening, everybody. I want to welcome you to First Baptist Church and our evening worship service. Thank you so much for blessing us with your attendance tonight. It's an honor to be in the house of the Lord tonight. I want to begin by reading out of the book of 1 Corinthians, 1 Corinthians chapter 2, starting in verse 1. Paul says, "And I, when I came to you, brothers, did not come proclaiming to you the testimony of God with lofty speech or wisdom, for I decided to know nothing among you except Jesus Christ and Him crucified. And I was with you in weakness and in fear and much trembling, and my speech and my message were not in plausible words of wisdom, but in demonstration of the Spirit and of power, so that your faith might not rest in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God." Well, let us pray. Lord Jesus, we thank you, Lord, for this evening you've given us. Thank you for this great and glorious day that you've given us. Thank you for the great day of morning of worship we had. And Lord, we thank you that tonight we get to come back and sing your praises and then go back to your word. And may we, like Paul, know nothing but Christ Jesus and Him crucified. May it all be about Jesus and Him living through us and Him glorifying Himself through us. And so, Lord, we give you this service. We love you and praise you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Come we that love the Lord, and let our joys be known. Join in a song with sweet accord, join in a song with sweet accord. And thus around the throne, and thus around the throne, we're marching to Zion, beautiful, beautiful Zion. We're marching upward to Zion, the beautiful city of God. Let those refuse to sing who never knew our God, but children of the heavenly King, but children of the heavenly King, may speak their joys abroad, may speak their joys abroad. We're marching to Zion, beautiful, beautiful Zion. We're marching upward to Zion, the beautiful city of God. Then let our songs abound and every tear be dry. We're marching through Emmanuel's round, we're marching through Emmanuel's round, to fairer worlds on high, to fairer worlds on high. We're marching to Zion, beautiful, beautiful Zion. We're marching upward to Zion, the beautiful city of God. A mighty fortress is our God, a bulwark never failing. Our helper, He amid the flood of mortal ills prevailing. For still our ancient foe not seek to work us woe. His craft and power are great, and armed with cruel hate. On earth
Thank you, Brother Mark, for leading us in that wonderful hymn of praise, that hymn that was written by the reformer Martin Luther. And I'm so grateful that we do have a mighty fortress in Christ Jesus who holds us firm in the tribulations of life as we look to Him and we cling to Him. Well, tonight we want to go back to the book of Proverbs. We're going to conclude our study in the book of Proverbs tonight by going to the final chapter, and that is Proverbs 31. And no, tonight is not Mother's Day. This is going to seem like it's a Mother's Day message, but what we learn in this text is certainly timeless in its application, whether we talk about it at Mother's Day or we talk about it in the middle of February. So we're going to talk tonight about the excellent woman. If you were to conduct a survey in the world and ask the world what would be the marks of an excellent woman or a great woman, first and foremost, the emphasis would be on the physical. We know this in this culture in which we live, in which much importance is placed on the outward person. They would also say that an excellent woman is smart, she is intelligent, she is ambitious, she is one who has a successful career. Tonight we look at Proverbs 31, and in this we are given the description of the excellent woman. And before we look at verses 10 through 31 in detail, I want to briefly mention the first nine verses. This is kind of the context for what we talk about tonight. This is a mother. She is writing to her son, who happens to be a king, this King Lemuel. And this mother speaks words of wisdom to her son. And she warns her son not to be negatively influenced by ungodly women and alcohol. She says, those will destroy you. And she goes on to encourage him to care for those who are under his care and to ensure righteousness and fairness for all, and certainly for the weak and the needy. And then lastly, as we open up our text tonight, she paints out for her son a picture of the ideal woman. This is not an actual woman that we know of, But this is just a portrait of the godly woman. And each of these verses, there's 22 verses, and this is a... Each verse begins with a letter of the Hebrew alphabet, so it's kind of fascinating in the way that it is written. So I want to mention, as we look at verses 10 through 31 in detail, we learn about the marks of the excellent woman, and you will find that the emphasis is not on the physical, but it's on her character. And so I've broken this down into three sections. So first of all, the excellent woman is known by her concern for her husband. And we see that in verses 10 through 12 and then verse 23. And then we're going to follow up by seeing that the excellent woman is known by her care for her family in 13 and 21, or 29, 13 through 29. And then lastly, we see that God describes for us the excellent woman, and he tells us that she is known for her commitment to her Lord. So first of all, let's look at her concern for her husband. Her chief concern is for her husband. You go back to the Garden of Eden. We know that Adam was formed first, and then God said that he would create for Adam a helpmate, one who would come alongside and help Adam. And this is her concern. This is her passion. It's for her husband. And you notice as we look in these verses, verse 10, an excellent wife, who can find? She is far precious than jewels. And that is so true. And tonight, give thanks for your wife. Men, I'm grateful that God in his mercy and his grace has blessed me with a godly wife in Michelle. And I'm so thankful for all that she does to minister to me and to support me and to love me unconditionally. And so this mother is encouraging her son to find this kind of woman to marry. She says the heart of her husband trusts in her, and he will have no lack of gain. She does him good and not harm all the days of her life. And so she is faithful to her husband. And thus, her husband trusts her. He has much confidence in her. She is committed to helping her husband to fulfill his responsibilities as a man and as a leader of his home. You notice there in verse 12 that she does him good, not harm, all the days of her life. And then you skip down to verse 23. Her husband is known in the gates, when he sits among the elders of the land. In ancient Israel, the elders, the men would gather together in the center of the city, at the city gates, and they would discuss different important things, different business deals and such. And because this excellent woman, this godly woman, is concerned for her husband, he has a good reputation. His success can be attributed to the fact that he has a godly wife who supports him and encourages him. And you know, it's interesting when you watch many television programs and movies and sitcoms today, and the relationship, the dynamic between a husband and a wife, which is becoming less and less. The family is becoming something that is quickly being attacked. But even when you find a television program where you have a family where there is a husband and a wife, so often the wife is not supportive of her husband, but instead she's demeaning towards her husband. Often the husband is portrayed as just some kind of goofy individual, and the wife is overbearing, and she's not out to support him. And that's sad, because here we find that God's description of a godly woman, an excellent woman, is one who helps her husband. She cares. Her concern is for her husband. Outside of her love for the Lord, her greatest concern is her husband, to build him up and to encourage him. And thus, he has a good name in the community. His name is can be trusted because of his reputation. So we see, first of all, the excellent woman is known by her concern for her husband. But then we look at the bulk of the verses, and we look at 13 through 29, and we see that she is also known by her care for her family. Her care for her family. She wears many hats as she ministers to her family. As we've already seen, she's married, obviously she has a husband that she ministers to, but she has children. She is a manager of her home. She manages her home well. She is a realtor. She is a farmer. She is a merchant. She ministers to her neighbor. She does all of these things. And so as we look at her care for her family, there's three things that really stand out specifically. Again, she cares for her home. She manages her home well. Proverbs 14:1 says, "The wisest of women builds her house, but folly with her own hands tears it down." And as we've looked at the book of Proverbs, we've seen many times wisdom is personified as a woman. We see here that this woman, this is a wise woman. She cares for her family. She works to build her family up. Her home is built up. It's not torn down by foolishness and carelessness. So she serves her family selflessly, and she does it with a spirit of joy. She does not do it begrudgingly, but she does it with joy because she knows that this is what she's been called to. This is her ministry. Her home is her ministry. And we will see that all of these things that she does, she also has this entrepreneurial skill. She is responsible with money. She is wise with the financial resources that she helps to bring to the family. So let's just look at these verses in detail. Starting in verse 13, it says, "She seeks wool and flax and works with willing hands." So she is one who is a seamstress. She works with the wool and the flax, and she does it with willing hands. Again, that speaks of her, of the joy that she finds in ministering to the needs of her family. Verse 14, "She is like the ships of the merchant. She brings her food from afar." So she helps to provide for her family. She cooks for her family, and she is creative in the meals that she provides for her family like a merchant. She goes out seeking those unique things to make creative meals because, again, she wants the very best for her family. Verse 15, "She rises while it is yet night and provides food for her household and portions for her maidens." So this is just telling us that she is not lazy by any figment of the imagination. And instead, she uses her time very wisely, and she rises up early in the morning. That's what it means when it says that she rises while it is yet night. So before everyone else in the household is started their day, she has been up already doing all these things, providing, again, for the needs of her household, and even those who serve possibly in her household. Verse 16, "She considers a field and she buys it. With the fruit of her hand, she plants a vineyard." So this speaks of her ability to, again, manage money well, and she purchases a field and she plants a vineyard. Verse 17, "She dresses herself with strength and makes her arms strong." Because of all that she does to minister to the needs of her family, she is physically strong. She is not weak. Verse 18, "She perceives that her merchandise is profitable. Her lamp does not go out at night." Again, so she's up early in the morning, but she's up late at night. Again, ministering to the needs of her family. She's not lazy. She does not spend her time throughout the day just sitting on the couch, watching TV, sitting on Facebook. No, she's ministering to the needs of her family so that her husband and her family can confidently go out and do the things that they've been called to do. Verse 19, she puts her hands to the staff and her hands hold the spindle. So this woman is described as one who not only is a maker of clothes, but she apparently makes her own thread. Verse 20, she opens her hand to the poor and reaches out her hands to the needy. And so we'll come to that in just a moment. She is not afraid of snow for her household, for all her household are clothed in scarlet. So what is that saying? She's not afraid. She's not taken off guard when cold weather comes because she has already diligently prepared her family. She has made clothing for her family so that when the cold weather comes, they're properly clothed. And there where it says that they're clothed in scarlet, that possibly speaks of she clothes them well. She used well-quality material. She makes bed coverings for herself. Her clothing is fine linen and purple. Again, we quoted verse 23. She makes linen garments, sells them. She delivers sashes to the merchant. So again, she not only works hard to make clothing for her own family, but she also, on top of all her other responsibilities, she's making garments, and she goes and she sells these garments. Strength and dignity are her clothing. She laughs at the time to come. She opens her mouth with wisdom, and the teaching of kindness is on her tongue. She looks well to the ways of her household and does not eat the bread of idleness. And so therefore her children rise up and call her blessed, her husband also, and he praises her. So she ministers, she cares for her family. She does all these different things to make sure the needs of her family are taken care of. But we ended here in these verses, in verse 26 and 27, that she has this powerful influence on her family. She opens her mouth with wisdom, and the teaching of kindness is on her tongue. So that just speaks of the wisdom that she invests into her children as well. So she cares for her home. Again, she serves her family selflessly, but she does it joyfully. And she has these entrepreneurial skills. Again, she is she can be trusted with the financial resources. Not only does she spend the money carefully, and she's very guarded with how she spends the family's money, but she also has wisdom to contribute financially to the family. So she's not about wasteful spending. So she cares for the needs of her home, but we also saw that she cares for her neighbors as well. You go back to verse 20, where it says she opens her hand to the poor and reaches out her hands to the needy. So this woman that we have described here is certainly not about living for self. She lives for her Lord by living for her family, but also she cares and she loves her neighbors and those who are in need, so she ministers to them generously. And then verse 20 even speaks of the fact that as she cares for her home and she cares for her neighbor, but she also is careful to take care of herself. Again, verse 22, she makes bed coverings for herself. And her clothing is fine linen and purple. And so you just envision a well-made bed. It's carefully tucked. There's no wrinkles. This is just a way of describing the way that this excellent woman, she takes care of herself. It is important that she presents herself well. She wants to represent her husband and her family well. So in no way is this woman a slob, as we might say, but she doesn't let herself go. She takes care of herself because she wants to represent her Lord well, who is the creator of beauty, but she represents her family well. This is a classy lady, as she is careful in how she takes care of her own self. And so this woman here, she is this excellent woman. She is known for the concern she has for her husband, but also for the care that she has for her family. And then we conclude in verses 30 and 31, and we see the excellent woman is known by her commitment to her Lord. And you see that in verse 30. Starting in verse 29, let's just start there. Many women have done exceedingly, but you surpass them all. Charm is deceitful, and beauty is vain. But a woman who fears the Lord is to be praised. Give her of the fruit of her hands, and let her works praise her in the gate. So this is like the climax of this description of the excellent woman, this godly woman. She is known by her commitment to the Lord. You know what's interesting about the book of Proverbs is Proverbs begins with this idea of the fear of the Lord. Going all the way back to Proverbs chapter 1, verse 7, it speaks of the fear of the Lord. We know that the beginning of wisdom is the fear of the Lord. And so, like bookends, the book of wisdom begins with this idea of fearing the Lord, and then it concludes with this personification of the fear of the Lord. And so it is her commitment to the Lord, the reverence, the respect that she has for the Lord, that is what ultimately drives her. That is what gives her her love for her husband and her family and for her neighbor. That is the source of her strength. She's able to do all these things that we're given here because God is her strength and God is her love. And that is what drives her. And ultimately, our character, because remember I told you that the emphasis here is on her character. It's not on the physical, but it's on her character. Our character ultimately is an indicator of our heart towards God. Do we have a healthy fear of God? A healthy fear, a healthy reverence of the Lord plays out in the way that we love our spouse, in the way that we love our family, and we love others. And so she is committed to the Lord. She spends time in God's Word. Her identity as a woman comes from her understanding of who she is in Christ. She recognizes that her beauty is not so much about the outward, but her beauty is in the Lord. It's who she is in the Lord. And so she loves the Lord. She is committed to the Lord. She spends time in God's Word and she prays and she is faithful to serve the Lord. And so the excellent woman is known by her commitment to her Lord. So in the way of application in conclusion, this is a high calling. This is the picture, again, of the ideal woman. And certainly nobody can live up to this perfectly. And of course, a lot of what we see this woman doing is applicable specifically to her culture. A lot of these things are not necessary anymore in the culture in which we live, but these character traits are very applicable. And so, ladies, don't look at this as a way of, don't leave this feeling condemned. But just see this as a challenge, something to look to as a model as you seek to be the woman that God has called you to be. And no doubt, if you come to this scripture with integrity and with honesty, you will see areas in your life that you're falling short in. And that is the whole purpose. God gives us this not to harm us, but to help us. And so as you look to this ideal woman, this excellent woman, learn from it. And if there's areas in your life that you're falling short in, repent. Seek the forgiveness of God and change. And so, ladies, maybe tonight your concern is not for your husband. You don't see him as your ministry. You're not helping him to be the man that God has called him to be. Your focus is not on your family. You are not resourceful in your time. You're not using your time wisely. You're not ministering to the needs of your family in some sort of way. Or maybe you're even failing in your commitment to the Lord. Again, let this speak to you not as a way of condemnation, but in loving correction. And all of us can learn from this. Us men as well, there's character traits here that are fitting for all of God's people. And so we learn from this woman. But then I close with this challenge to us as men and to children who've been blessed with godly mothers. May we honor the godly women in our lives. I go back to verse 28. Her children rise up and call her blessed, her husband also, and he praises her. So may we be faithful to support and encourage our wives' husbands. May we thank them for all that they do, and may we minister to them. And may we come alongside them and help them, and may we pray for them that they, like us, will be faithful to keep our eyes upon the Lord. None of us can be the people that God has called us to be unless we first are tapping into the vine, which is Jesus Christ. And so we're grateful for God's Word. We're grateful for this book of wisdom. As I started this study in the book of wisdom with this challenge, that every day you read the proverb of the day. And I want to conclude this study with the same challenge, that every day you read the proverb of the day. So today is February 21st. Did I get that right? February 21st? Yep. So today, read Proverbs 21, because there's so much wisdom in this book. We've talked about a lot of things in this book, but we certainly have not talked about everything. And so every day I challenge you to just read the proverb of the day and let God speak to your heart and teach you about wisdom. And remember, the beginning of wisdom begins with the fear of the Lord. And the fear of the Lord begins with surrender. Surrendering your life to Jesus Christ. Maybe tonight you're listening as a woman and you're defeated. You're discouraged because you have failed in so many ways. We all have. That's why we need a Savior. And so look to Jesus Christ. Let Him cleanse you and let Him begin a new work in you. Receive Him as Christ or as Lord of your life. Well, let us pray. Lord Jesus, we thank You for Your Word. Lord, we thank You for this picture of the excellent woman. And Lord, I thank You, Father, for the wife that You have given me. I thank You for all the godly women that make up this church. And Lord, we pray for them that they would find their identity, that they would find their calling, not according to what culture says, but they would find it in the Word of God. And in the days in which we live, Your Word cuts against the grain of society. Society laughs at this. We know that this is Your Word. And so, Lord, I pray for the ladies that they would look to You, that they would be committed to You. I pray for us as husbands that we would be the husbands You've called us to be. And we thank You, O Lord, for Your grace. We thank You for Your forgiveness. We all need a Savior because we all fall very, very short. And so, Lord, we thank You again for this great day that You've given us. Lord, as we start a new week, may we be faithful to represent You well. We love You, Lord Jesus, and we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, again, thank you so much for joining us tonight. I hope that you have a wonderful week. Remember, church family, we have Wednesday night meals again that are being made available to you. If you have not signed up yet, please sign up. You will be blessed, and it helps as we come on Wednesday nights for Wednesday night prayer meeting, so you can get the meal knocked out. And you can come and be a part of the fellowship here at 6:30 on Wednesday nights. God bless you. Have a wonderful evening.